Welcome to Awaken and Power TV. I'm your host, Ethann Fox. I'm joined today by Reuben Langdon. Reuben is an actor, stuntman, and martial artist who's worked alongside the likes of Jackie Chan and with movie directors such as Steven Spielberg. Today we'll be speaking about his career in these various fields and how it's led him in the direction of investigating extraterrestrial and extradimensional contact. We find out what he's learned in his various investigations working with intuitive channels such as Michaela Sheldon, my co-host, and in the documentary film that he produces called Extradimensionals. And we talk about what the different extradimensionals foresee as the future of the human race. So without any further delay, here's Reuben Langdon. Hello, Reuben. Welcome to Awaken and Power TV. Thank you for joining me today. It's a pleasure for me to have you on my show. I've heard a lot about you, and of course, you were out here in our area recently doing an interview with Michaela Sheldon, my co-host on the show. So welcome, and thank you for joining me today.
Thanks, Ethan. Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure. And I'd like to start, you've got a really interesting life, and I'd love to hear more about some of the things that you've done in the acting world and so on. So can you kind of give us an overview, and then I'll ask some questions to get more into detail in the different areas, but an overview of your career in the acting industry, both abroad as well as in the U.S. and Hollywood, and some of the more notable things that you've done.
Sure. Yeah, I'm, I guess, out in the ether, the internet world, and in the movie world, I'm more known for my work in video games and motion capture. Or I should say voiceover, motion capture, video games, and films. But particularly with a character named Dante from the Devil May Cry series, there seems to be quite a big fan base with that series and with my portrayal of that role, of that character. And I started back when I was 19, I moved to Japan and got into martial arts and got into acting out in Japan for a TV series called B-Fighter Kabuto. And I was the high school exchange student helping save the day with transforming into this kind of Power Ranger-esque superhero. And that sort of got me propelled into this world of action, Power Ranger type superhero action stuff. I was a huge fan of Jackie Chan prior to getting that role, and then later went to Hong Kong and ended up working with him. And I sort of had this action cinema, video game, superhero theme going in throughout my career and my life. And a lot of people out there in the internet world know me more for my portrayal of these characters. Ken Masters from the series of Street Fighter, I do the voiceover for that character. And I've worked with Jackie Chan, and another, I think, big accomplishment that many people don't actually see me as, but I was sort of the body double, stunt double for Sam Worthington in Avatar. So the Jake Sully character. I spent 4 years with James Cameron and worked on that film as sort of the main physical. Whenever Jake Sully's running, flying, jumping, doing anything physical, that was mostly my work. And as well as a lot of the Navi movements in the background, where they're sort of, you know, in the as Jake's going through the home tree and discovering this world, a lot of those background Navi characters were me and a bunch of other guys, but a lot. That was, I spent 4 years doing a lot of that stuff. So fun, exciting, action-packed career I've had, but a lot of it has to do with this motion capture technology and integrating that technology. The same technology that was used in Avatar, and then integrating that into video games and producing. I've done a lot of producing over the past few years in the video game spectrum realm. So that's a very broad, brief explanation there, but we can go into more details if you had any questions.
So, and you've also been in Power Rangers and Star Wars and quite a number of other movies too, right?
Well, I worked on some Star Wars video games. I've never been in the actual movies, which would be an awesome experience. That would be an honor to work on especially the new J.J. Abrams series, which I just saw the trailer, the other day. It was jaw-dropping and, an awe moment. But yeah, I'm a huge fan of science fiction, and that sort of being in the industry working on these projects is sort of a dream come true, being able to work and play and hang out with James Cameron or these big names and then help create some of this stuff. So this was all most of my heavy career stuff was pre my what I'm doing now in the ET spectrum.
So what are some of the more notable actors or movie producers who you've worked with over the years?
Well, I had the honor to work with James Cameron, Steven Spielberg, and Peter Jackson all at the same time on the film Tintin, where they utilized the motion capture technology. They were actually using, for early tests, they were using Cameron's studio and some of the technology he developed for Avatar. They were using it in the Tintin test. So all in the same room at the same time, being directed by Spielberg and Peter Jackson. Cameron was kind of off to the side, making sure the technology was working. And Andy Circus was there as well. So I got to sort of work with him and do a fight scene with him. And that was one of my career highlights, just having everybody in the same room at the same time. It was quite something. But no, I've worked with, a whole slew of actors and directors and people that you would just, I'm like going blank now on some of the names and experiences, but I worked on Pirates of the Caribbean 3. It was a huge stunt scene with two ships kind of battling and swinging from ropes to each ship, and they had these giant gimbals, and it's really a privilege to be working in the sort of the mainstream Hollywood film industry, because you get to see these great big budgeted expensive productions, and I do work on a lot of low budget stuff as well, so it's always shifting. More recently I worked on the film Ant-Man, which is out now. Can't really see me in there. I was doing more behind the scenes action preparation and action design on some of the stuff. Let me see. Obviously, the cast and crew of Avatar, Sam Worthington, Sigourney Weaver. Recently, I got to work with Jamie Foxx for a little fight thing on a new film he's doing. And got to get kicked by him, and it's always nice to get kicked by a famous star and have a little scar or something. Then you can show, oh, this is Jamie Foxx, this is Sam Worthington, this is you can kind of show the wounds and then explain which ones are who. So it's kind of a fun thing.
Weren't you also in Bourne Identity or something?
I worked in the video games. There was a Bourne Identity video game series, actually, and I portrayed Jason Bourne in the series, in a couple of the games, I guess. And the great thing about video games is you can sort of be the hero, you can be the villain, and just background people kind of all in the same day. Because it's with the motion capture technology, you're just wearing the suit and they just push a button and they can sort of switch which character you're portraying. So I remember working on that series and just being all the characters, like a random bum in the park. And yeah, now I'm Jason Bourne, and then I'm the villain. And so a lot of times in the video games, they don't have budgets. Well, they're starting to have the budgets of the big Hollywood films. But back in the day, they hire one or two performers, and we perform all the characters in the game. So, but it's cool, again, to be able to be the, you know, these characters in the films that you sort of idolize and you know, want to be, you can. In the motion capture world, you can, it's just a click of the button, now you're this character, now I'm this guy. So that's the beauty of that, of the technology, but it's also the downfall of the technology is nobody knows who I am. This is me, my face, but nobody sees it. It's just performances. So
I have a huge fan base for Dante, don't you?
Yeah, that one, because I performed both the physical movements and the, so the motion capture as well as the voice of the character. I guess there's a little more, I have a little more oomph to that, and people recognize the voice. It's funny, people recognize the voice more than movements. I guess it's obvious, but there's several characters I've portrayed doing the motion capture for the Jason Bourne, for example, Jason Bourne and the Bourne Identity, where it wasn't my voice, but it was my physical movements. But you don't really get noticed for that. There's another character I've been portraying the physical movements for several years, and his name's Chris Redfield in the Resident Evil series. And many people know that character, but they have no idea that I've been performing the movements for that character over the years. So, because the voice again is somebody else's voice. So it's a cool world, but for me, the live action world is sort of the cream of the crop, because it's your physicality and it's your voice and everything that goes with it.
What was it like to be acting with Jackie Chan? What's he like in person, as he is in the movies, or different?
Yeah, he's super positive. He's super, I just want to say he's probably one of the most hardest working guys that I've ever seen on set, just because of the physicality that he puts into the films, but also just the mental action design. He's in front of the camera and behind, and just works all angles. And he knows lighting, he knows grip work, he knows, acting and direction for the extras in the background. And he just really gets involved and puts himself in everything. And he's very strict about it. So in the outside perception of Jackie, he's very, and I guess on a day-to-day basis, he's very happy and caring for his fans and for the general public. But on set, he's actually very strict, like uber strict, sort of shifts into this very serious mode of we're working now and there's no goofing off. So where his kind of outside persona is very, very much a wisecracker, sort of, you know, laid back kind of guy, but he's on set, he's not laid back at all, very strict, which is something to be respected, I think. It's not a downfall at all.
And I know you've got a pretty extensive martial arts background. What exactly, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, it's more of a movie foo, I call it, you know, Hong Kong action, where I've studied many different martial arts for the practical martial artness, I guess that's the word, of the martial arts and the mindsets. I mean, one of my biggest heroes growing up was Bruce Lee, and the philosophy behind the martial arts and everything that goes with martial arts, I'm very much a big fan of. However, most of my martial art training has been in sort of fake martial arts for films. So I would take pieces and bits of real martial arts the stuff that works well that works well in the films, and then focus in and train specifically for those movements. So I guess in real world martial arts, I wouldn't really call myself much of a martial artist. I'd probably get my butt kicked if you were to throw me in a ring with somebody, but I could fake it really well. I could probably fake that I'm doing some good stuff for a bit until the other person realizes that I really don't have much practical martial arts skills. So, but yeah, a bit of everything. It's the films, depending on the character, depending on the direction of the film and the style of the scene, and there's just so many different aspects that go into creating a martial arts fighting scene that I've had over the years to really study everything, and I'm always looking for new movements, new techniques, new things that I can incorporate that may not even be martial arts. It's gymnastics, breakdancing, you name it, all kinds of different things, movements that I can grab and take and then incorporate it and make it look like a martial art or a fighting style of some sorts.
So if we had Reuben Langdon versus Jackie Chan, who would win?
Probably Jackie Chan, because he has, well, not probably, definitely Jackie Chan. Just because Jackie has been, he's actually done some pretty hardcore training in the real martial arts. And in his younger years, I remember reading and watching him train in some kung fu styles that were very practical kung fu stuff, which he later would incorporate into his film stuff. But I've been really, other than about a year worth of jiu-jitsu training, Brazilian jiu-jitsu training, which is still white belt, still an uber beginner. Everything I've been doing in my life has been for the screen, for action cinema. So I would not hold up very well.
You've done quite a few commercials, I know, abroad too. Have you done US commercials as well?
I've done a handful. Most of my US work is in the stunt action field. So the commercials I've done here is doubling an actor or helping rig, do some stunt rigging, wire work kind of thing. So I'm pretty versed in that. Or I do a lot of stunt coordinating as well, which is more specific to the martial arts sort of fighting genres. If a project requires that sort of skill sets, then that's when I'll get the call, because of my background working in Asia and working with Jackie Chan and working with those Asian crews. I've acquired a unique skill set in the martial arts world.
Now, have you always had, and I'm going in a direction with this, I watched a lot of your older material and I'm trying to understand the new direction, which we're going to talk a little bit about the new direction you're going in with projects in your life. But I noticed that, for example, B-Fighter Kabuto is, there seems to be this sort of alien theme throughout a lot of the things that you do, right? Was there something in those earlier works that inspired or got you thinking about the work that we're going to be discussing in a few minutes? Or were there some earlier experiences maybe from your childhood that inspired that thinking?
Well, I'd always been interested in science fiction, as I mentioned, sort of, and I wouldn't specifically say aliens. Aliens fascinated me, and I loved, you know, Independence Day and all of the alien movies, Close Encounters and E.T., the sort of bigger, you know, Hollywood, big budgeted alien-themed films always impressed me. I'm a huge Star Trek fan from a very young age. And I was sort of unconsciously drawn to these themes, and both in being a fan of these of these works, and then sort of getting into them as an actor and performer, I think I just sort of gravitated into those worlds and loved it and loved what I was doing. I remember my first day on the job of B-Fighter Kabuto. I remember I got to run. All my lines and dialogue were in Japanese. So I was, you know, speaking in Japanese, transforming into this, you know, superhero, fighting the bad guys, these, you know, monster alien looking things, just guys in rubber suits. But, and then doing, you know, jumping off a trampoline and punching and doing these movements. And I thought, man, this is a blast. I'm going to do this the rest of my life. This is, and it was my 21st birthday. So I've sort of have kept that idea and that remembering that day and always moving forward, just thinking that, okay, this is what I'm going to do the rest of my life. And I sort of have been. I mean, I've had to veer off and do different things, but it's all sort of been associated with this superhero kind of, you know, fighting the aliens, or, you know, this kind of theme stuff, which is it. And then going to anime conventions and comic cons and these sort of things, that's what sort of thrives. Those themes and those projects thrive and keep that going. And I love it. I'm a fan as well as I have fans. So it's I get where they're coming from, and I interact with them on a level. I think that a lot of, you know, people in this industry are sort of look at it as a job and just do their job and go home. But no, I live, breathe, and eat this stuff for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Were there any earlier childhood influences? I ask that because most people who have an interest or a fascination with extraterrestrial or extradimensional areas that I've interviewed and spoken with over the years usually have some sort of early childhood influence or interaction with extradimensionals. Was there anything like that for you? I mean, what was your childhood like?
Well, not consciously, but so I did have a mom that was sort of out there, I guess, as a growing up. She was very metaphysical and very much into alternative belief systems, especially at my age at that time. My mom and dad divorced when I was young, when I was about 6 or 7 years old. And they sort of separated because of their belief systems. And my dad was very much a Christian, Baptist Christian in Atlanta is where I grew up. And my mom really started going the metaphysical route. And I sort of back and forth between the two, not really knowing, you know, just taking it all in as a kid. You don't, I didn't subscribe to any specific belief system. But my mom would talk about aliens, and she would talk about alternative energies and, you know, things that came along with the metaphysical belief system, which sort of now is, I don't even know if we have the term metaphysical anymore. It sort of is opened up into a whole new thing. But she had said a lot of the stuff, and growing up as a child, I always leaned more towards what my dad's belief systems and at school with friends. So none of my friends were talking about aliens, and none of my friends were talking about, you know, alternative energies or anything like that. So I kind of just pushed all that stuff into that's my mom, she's in another world kind of thing. And it wasn't until I had my own experiences much later in life, which was, you know, back in 2007. And then I was kind of like, oh my God, my mom's right. So no, growing up, I really didn't, other than just having that, my mom sort of whisper things in my ear from her discoveries and her experiences and her journey. I can't say I have any conscious contact of sorts.
So what was the experience in 2007 you mentioned?
So, where all of this started with me going on this whole sort of another path was during the making of Avatar, while I was on set, I got exposed to the Zeitgeist films. And I say on set, it was just, well, we were, there was a number of, a handful of us actors and performers that would hang out offset during the creation of Avatar, because the computers and the motion capture technology that Cameron was pushing was very advanced, and there was a lot of computer issues. So there was a lot of downtime where we would be doing our thing, you know, playing Navis, doing our motion capture thing, and then there'd be a crash. They call it SC, or they had code words for these different crashes, and the whole computer system would shut down and they'd have to reboot it and go through the process. So that usually meant we had a couple hours to just kind of hang out. So we would always go in the back room, a handful of us, and fire up YouTube. And we joke that collectively at that time in 2007 or six, because YouTube was just coming out, we'd probably seen every single video on YouTube. At the time, now we could not make that claim, but at the time, we were just going through everything, all the cat videos, everything you could possibly think of. And we stumbled upon, I think, Loose Change and Zeitgeist. And that really just sort of, this whole concept that 9/11 was an inside job really did a mind thing on me, because I was very much a mainstream guy. And as well as, you know, the whole opening 30 minutes of Zeitgeist talks about the different religions and belief systems, and sort of makes the comparisons between Christianity and the Egyptian religions and all these other religions, and just sort of really makes you kind of think about archetypes and different things. So my mind started getting massaged. It was actually getting hammered, I should say, by the Zeitgeist films. And then moving, it was shortly after that, I had a day off from work, and I was just doing laundry out at my apartment complex in Glendale, California, dropping my laundry off in the laundromat and going back to my apartment. I sort of looked up and I saw these what looked like sort of stars in the sky, in a clear blue sky, in the middle of the day. And I couldn't figure it out. My mind was trying to wrap around what these things were. I thought they were little white gnats, you know, that you see sometimes depending on the country you live in. And I was trying to put my hand out and get this sort of perspective thing. And are they there? How far out are they? And then I saw a plane fly through them, and the plane was closer where they were really far out there. And more of them appeared, and there was about 20 or 30 of these white, I can say it was orbs or discs. It was hard to describe if they were actually, or hard to tell if they were actually, craft, you know, physical craft, or if they were just bright lights in the sky. But I was going crazy. I started calling friends. I'm like, do you see what I've seen? You know, look up at the sky. Where are you at? And nobody, none of my friends that I could get on the phone were able to see it. But I thought that was it. This mass sighting of some sort of extraterrestrial thing. And the whole world, it's going to be on the news that night. And the whole world's going to know about this. And this is, you know, groundbreaking, a huge event. You know, watch the news. I was anxious to watch the news that night, and nothing on the news. And the next morning I checked the papers. I'm like, wait, what's going on? There's nothing. No, how come nobody's talking about this? So I started searching the internet more and more, and I saw similar things. There's a famous Mexico City, mass sighting, which was sort of like that. The objects look sort of like that. And I found others that people had taken video. So I thought, okay, it's a familiar phenomenon. I'm not the only one. But nobody had video of the event that I saw. But that really just kind of opened my mind. It was hammered with Zeitgeist, and now my brain was just leaking out with this newfound experience. And I just started researching and going deep. I guess trying to find news, that the news on the event. I discovered all of this ET stuff, that there's just massive sightings all over the place. And the mainstream was not talking about it. And then I started asking the questions of, why isn't the mainstream talking about this? If all these people are having these experiences. And then I sort of remembered my mom speaking of these things growing up, abductions and, you know, the whole ET phenomenon. And it just, that's when my curiosity got sparked. And I happened to have been playing an alien on Avatar, you know, doing this Navi thing. So I just started seeking and researching and going as deep as I could.
And at what point did you, did that redirect your career? At which point did you start moving toward the extra-dimensional and extraterrestrial reporting aspect of the work that you're doing now?
Well, I sort of, after that experience in 2007, I sort of, you know, amongst friends, we would talk about, you know, if other people had experiences and sort of share information, but I sort of kept it on the DL from most people. You know, I didn't want the world to think I'm this crazy UFO guy, which now the whole world knows I'm this crazy UFO guy. But at the time, I didn't want that out there, because we had this, I had a career and I didn't know what people were going to think, and if people thought, you know, they wouldn't hire me because I had these strange beliefs or these strange experiences. So I didn't talk about it in public until in 2010, I signed up for one of Stephen Greer's C5 events. And this was out in Tucson, Arizona. And went to that and, he had a number of guests there, and it was a 3-day event, and he's talking about the free energy and Nikola Tesla, and took a ton of notes. And every night we'd go out and do a CE5 and saw things that could not be explained. And it blew my mind even more. It was like, it was sort of a validation that yes, all this stuff is really happening. You know, to physically have those experiences where, you know, you're calling them, you're summoning, and you're sort of seeing things in the sky that that even Stephen Greer wasn't seeing. Because there was one time we were preparing for the C5, and I looked off to the left and I saw two red orbs going at incredible speeds, and sort of nudged my partner, and he saw it. And then there was a small group of us while Greer was still, you know, speaking, getting ready and preparing for the C5 event. So having seen those and having that experience, I'm like, okay, so it's not just a magic show, you know, at the time thinking that Greer is, you know, got some lasers set up somewhere and he's going to do some kind of thing. So that kind of validated it for me that it wasn't just Greer putting on a magic show. So after that event, it just had such a profound, influence on me. And I, so then that's when I sort of went public, I guess. I had enough validation from external sources to say, okay, this phenomenon is real. There's, this energy stuff is real. Enough people, you know, whistleblowers, insiders are talking about this stuff. I guess I can talk about it now. So that's when I sort of went public with my findings, wrote a blog about that C5 experience. And then I started on my other interviews in the video game world. I sort of would spark a conversation by bringing it up and see where things would go. Most people just wanted to talk about Street Fighter or Devil May Cry, but I would try to nudge it in there wherever I could. And then that really started me on the path of seeking and gaining more information and talking with researchers and insiders and going down the path where I am now, where I'm still doing the film work, but I'm also on the side doing this, you know, the research and the extraterrestrial, extradimensional stuff.
So you're talking about CD5, you're talking about citizens disclosure hearings, right?
No, the C5 is it's a term coined by Greer where close encounters of the fifth kind, where humans initiate contact as opposed to being, you know, close encounters of the third kind, being taken or having experiences on ships. He coined this term of humans initiating contact. Are you familiar? Have you heard about the C5 stuff at all?
I'm familiar with the disclosure hearings, but okay. Not. Go ahead. Tell me more about that.
Yeah. So, the film Circus, which is sort of about Greer and his life's work, goes into it a little bit. So if people want to get more information, I recommend checking that film out. But it really is it goes into the power of intention and sort of going to a meditative state and remote viewing, in essence. Another star system, another galaxy, and Greer has a lot of meditation tools and things. I think even has a C5 app where he'll guide you through a meditation and help you connect in this meditation to an extraterrestrial being or beings or, you know, star system. And then you sort of vector them in and bring them back into our dimension, our reality. And by going through these protocols, you sort of have these experiences. And I've done them with Greer and I've done them without Greer. I've done them on my own with other people, and things happen. You see lights in the sky and sometimes followed by, you know, black helicopters or fighter jets. And it's a phenomenon that I very much agree with, that just because of my personal experiences. So this idea of summoning or putting out the intention and using intention to bring in beings of other galaxies or other dimensions with, you know, light craft. And it could be, you know, some of the things I've seen may not even be craft. It could be just orbs or energy fields or something, but it sort of proves this, the concept, the power of intention and bringing in actual physical things. And when you're in a group and you have the whole group, the larger the group, I'm sure on your show you've talked about the power of mass meditations and how that can actually have physical effects on, you know, on war or healing. Different people have had with the power of prayer and intention have had miraculous healings. Same sort of thing if you get a bunch of people in a group and you sort of meditate on contact, this concept of contact, strange things happen.
Now, a lot of people in the various movements, even the extraterrestrial movements, are not really sure what to make of Stephen Greer. There seems to be a lot of questionable opinions on both sides of the fence. Now, having worked closely with him, what's your opinion on the work that he's doing?
I think that his work is sound and it comes from a good place. The CE5 protocols, like I said, I had experienced them with him in these groups, but also on my own taking the protocols with smaller groups and just myself out in the woods at night, you know, staring into the stars and sort of had strange experiences. All positive, you know, they're just lights in the sky, really. Greer himself, yes, I think he's controversial in the field because he has a very strong opinion on certain things. And he, you know, he's sort of very bullish in his attitude. And I think that just, turns people off or makes people, irritates people a little bit. But overall, I'd say his C5 stuff is spot on, and he's been doing groundbreaking work, you know, with the original Disclosure project in 2001, where he had brought these whistleblowers out together, and then he continues to do that work as far as getting whistleblowers and getting them on camera to testify and do things. As far as the other stuff, I don't know. I would say, you know, we don't need to go there, but his work seems to be sound, in my opinion, and from my research.
And at a certain point, you started your own 3D animation studio, right?
I had been going, I had started on a smaller scale back in 2001-ish, opened a company called Just Cause, and we were doing, even though the name sounds sort of like a metaphysical sort of name, but we were doing just mainstream production of video games and a lot of translation work, localization. I worked with a lot of Japanese companies and video game companies at the time doing, when I say localization, hiring talent, English-speaking talent to work on these Japanese projects, specifically with acting and script writing and taking their original Japanese product and trying to make it appeal to a broad Western audience as much as possible. So started doing that, and then while working on Avatar, we'd won a bid for the video game Resident Evil 5, and we won the bid as far as doing all the animation and visual effects and all the stuff that goes into making a video game in that aspect, which until then I'd only been sort of a performer and not, and hadn't dove into the actual technology aspects. And then once we won that bid, I went full on and had to learn the art of producing and doing visual effects in the visual effects world and understanding the technologies and, you know, putting together budgets, getting artists and making all that work.
Now, have you found, I've got sort of a philosophical question here, perhaps. Now, you've obviously studied a lot of these things like law of attraction and these kind of concepts. And now you play a lot of roles that have to do with violence and aggressive sort of behavior and shooting guns and wars and whatnot. And whether it's in the video game arena or in actual films, do you feel that that has any kind of an impact on you and your outlook on life and how you experience your life?
Yeah, this is something actually I've sort of had inner turmoil with, especially of recent, sort of going on this, I guess, metaphysical path, or this understanding of how energies work. And initially, I was sort of conflicted. I'm like, well, I get paid to beat people up, or I get paid to die. I often joke that I probably hold the world record for most deaths performed by a single person, because in the video game realm, I've spent days where I've died, you know, 200, 300 different ways in a single day, and doing those over and over again. So I feel like I probably have died every way you could possibly think of. And then, so thinking about that, the energetics behind that, and to this, and understanding, like you were saying, the law of attraction and things. And I sort of have shifted my perception, because I look at the video game industry, and the people in the video game industry are some of the most loving, laid back, just amazing people. And when you look at all the violence and the craziness and all this stuff, and then you look at the people who are making it, it's actually, compared to the film industry, these people are, you know, everybody's so relaxed and wearing t-shirts and they're always happy, and, you know, nobody cares about, you know, they're not yelling at each other, and it's very laid back and just a nice, pleasant working environment. I really love working with video game people, because of that, because it's such a cool vibe of people. And then I always thought about that, like, well, on a daily basis, these people are, you know, they're blowing things up, they're killing, they're destroying. But then I looked at the energy. So again, looking at the energy behind things, these people are having fun and they're not emotionally attached to the emotion that comes along with, let's say, actually really killing somebody. I mean, that there's a lot of heavy emotions that would go into that. And if you talk to any war veterans or anybody who's been through experiences of that sort, it's very heavy. The people that are creating these video games are not putting that emotion into their projects. They're just having fun, and they're just—it's nonsense. Basically, it's like it's going to amusement park, and that's sort of the energy that's going behind their creation of these video games. Now, from time to time, there are kids that play these video games and get sort of a different emotional story, and they start feeling emotions in a different way that probably the intention behind the creation of the video games. And that's where I think things get sort of convoluted, and the issues that we have where we talk about, you know, video games are a negative influence on humanity. Overall, I would say they're not, but we do have to be careful where some kids and some people get sort of the wrong message, and they sort of feel into these games in a way that maybe initially wasn't intended. And then that energy then just gets more and more perverted, and that person then will, you know, go get a gun and, you know, do some school shootings. Does the game influence that? Absolutely. But would something else influence it? Absolutely. There's just, it's, I'd say overall in the video game world, the intention and the energy that goes into it is not anything near what is sort of, I guess in a broader sense, you know, the parents are looking at video games as causing all these problems. And I really don't think it's the video games that are causing the problems. It's the misinterpretation of some of the video games for certain select people, because most of the video game players, people that I know who play video games all the time, are also just as chill and just as laid back, and they're having a good time, and they don't take what's actually happening on the screen as literal emotions. The emotion behind it is not this intense darkness that's happening on the screen. Does that make any sense?
Yes, it does. Well, I'd like to expand on that a little bit and ask another question. So obviously you understand dimensions, and to some extent, I'm sure, because of all the other work you do. Right now, for example, we're experiencing a certain dimensional experience. We're having this conversation, right? And when we're done with this call, you're going to go on to something else, and it's a little different experience. So do you think, I mean, video games nowadays are getting so realistic looking that, now I'm not really into video games, but I imagine playing them feels more and more real to the player. And do you think that the people who play a lot of these video games are, it's almost like they're entering their own dimensional experience? Does that level of dimensional experience alter their perceptions of reality, whatever reality is? I mean, it's questionable is whether what you and I are having right now is reality, or is the video game reality, or is it all just different aspects or different dimensions of reality? But do you think that the video game experience or industry is creating this alternate dimensional reality that that is maybe changing people's experience of human existence in some way?
Absolutely. I think we're sort of creating, you know, my understanding from my research and my talks with these extra-dimensional beings is, you know, we're in a sort of a fragmented consciousness fourth dimensional, you know, third, fourth density reality, which in, you know, even our top scientists are saying we live in a video game. You know, we live in a holographic universe video game. And we're creating video games. We're using basically the same principle in how this reality works. And we're creating a three-dimensional or fourth-dimensional sort of virtual worlds. And in fact, the explanation of the holographic universe and based on the discussions, I have a whole PowerPoint panel that I do at anime conventions that talks about the holographic universe and the video game aspects of our universe. And I make the comparisons to video games and where we're going with video game engines and how they're constructed, and the physics behind those video games is actually the same physics that we have in this reality. So no, there is no difference. We are literally creating wormholes, dimensional realities, where we go into and we experience a whole nother reality on this other level. It's limited because of our programming skills, our computing power, but as we develop our technology and as quantum computing, we're on the verge of launching quantum computing, and as CPUs get bigger and greater, as you said, these new games are looking more realistic and greater, we're going to create entire worlds, entire dimensions, which literally is another dimension where we can enter into and experience things on another fractalized sort of consciousness in another way, just like our higher selves, our you know, our oversouls are sort of having this fractalized conscious experience in this video game world that we're living in, according to our scientist.
So if law of attraction works, and what we focus our attention on, and what we see as real or feel or experience as real within our own minds and our own emotions is what we bring into reality in our dimensional reality that we're experiencing at the moment, then let's say there was a video game out there that was, you know, a lot of people, when they create their vision board or whatever for law of attraction, they put on their money and cars and, you know, all kinds of things like that, because in a westernized society, that's what we all think we want. Mm-hmm. And whether or not that's really what we really want, that's what we all are convinced psychologically because of the influences in our society. It seems to me that video games are even more of an immersive experience. So what if, so if there was a video game that had to do with that subject material, then it probably would help me more to manifest those things in my life, I'm imagining. But by that same observation, then, would playing more aggressive video games maybe attract that kind of experience into my life, do you think?
Again, yeah, I think it comes down to the emotion and the intent behind the actual experience. So, you know, and Bashar says, you know, all truths are true, and that everything is, that all of this is a sort of a virtual reality, a holograph, and the only thing that's really true is the experience and the emotion that comes with it. And a lot of the different, through a lot of the channeled material, extra-dimensional studies, as well as my own sort of deep meditations, it seems like the only thing that's tangible from this entire experience at the end of it is the experience itself and the emotion that's created from it. You know, we have emotion that creates it, and then we kind of have a more detailed, a more refined emotional experience from it. So at the end of the day, everything, in my opinion, comes down to the emotional experience. So when you're playing this video game, what is the emotional experience that you're receiving from it? And is it one of, you know, hate and negativity and all of these sort of negative emotions that come along with doing negative things in this dimensional reality? Or is it of excitement and joy, and, you know, there's a lot of fright and scaredness, but most of these video game experiences are sort of thrills. And I think in a lot of ways, having that outlet, that thrilling experience in that holographic experience in that realm, it sort of gets it out of the system for a lot of people, so they don't need to necessarily create the crazy thrill rides in this reality. And we have, I mean, look at our history, of wars and destruction and, you know, battling. And I see probably in the future, there's going to be a shift, just like there's starting to be a shift in our films, where we're going to decide that we're done, you know, as we are in this third dimensional, fourth dimensional reality, we're sort of deciding that, you know, wars aren't really serving us anymore. All of the destruction and fighting and craziness, it was a good thrill, but we've gotten it out of our system, most of us, and we're sort of moving on. I think in the video game space, we've created these holographic realities for people to get all that thrill and excitement and get that done with, and then we can move into a newer space of thrills. There still are going to be thrills. There's always going to be thrills. There's always going to be amusement parks and roller coasters and sort of fun things to do. And I think that's where these holographic universes that we're creating in our video game spectrums are outlets to allow us to have these emotional experiences in a safe way, so it's not affecting us here. However, depending on the individual and depending on their interpretation and their emotional response to that, there's always the opportunity or the chance for something to get sort of twisted and manipulated and then bring that experience back into this reality and then twist it up and create havoc. So it's you know, like Spider-Man says, or Spider-Man's uncle, with great power comes great responsibility, and we are gaining power with our creation of these holographic universes, and it is a double-edged sword. And as long as we use it in a responsible way, then we'll, you know, I think we'll be fine. But not all of us are built the same. We don't all have the same emotional responses based on specific situations, so we just need to honor that and sort of keep an eye out for each other and see, you know, who can handle a video game and responsibly, and who can't. And those who can't, we put the lock on the game and put it in the safe and say, no, you can't have this.
Now, in your opinion, as video games are becoming more and more complex and realistic, do you think it matters whether somebody is experiencing a dimensional reality in a video game or in what we call real life? I mean, is experience experience? Does it make a difference?
Actually, no. I think it is sort of the same thing. There are depths of the reality. So as I was saying, you know, we're able to have this video game experience and have a very shallow emotional thrill, excitement. For the most part, most of us sort of turn on the game, play it for a day or two, have this excitement and these thrills come up and these emotions, and then we turn it off and we go back to our regular lives. And then we talk about it in our regular lives. We're like, hey, have you played that game? Wow, it was amazing. It really had this effect on me, and just like a movie. And you know, and that's sort of it. Some people get super involved. They take it to the next level. They go deeper than they probably should, you know, as far as what's healthy in this reality. And then they sort of disconnect from this reality, connect with that reality even more. And then there's an unhealthy relationship. Overall, I think in the video game spectrum, from what I've seen working and interacting with people who make the games and interacting with the fans who play the games, it seems to be a pretty healthy thing right now. But there are individuals who take it to that extra mile that go into this unhealthy relationship. Just like anything, just like with coffee, you and I were talking about coffee earlier. It's how does it serve you? And I think that's the question, you know, we need to ask with all aspects of our life, but really in the video game realms, how does it serve you? Does it have a positive influence or does it have a negative influence? And for each person and for each situation and for each game, it's going to be different. So we sort of collectively have to agree that that's the situation and just, you know, watch each other's backs. For those who are sort of not being served or being served in a negative way, call them out on it. And for those who continue to have positive experiences with video games, you know, let that grow and see. And that's what we are actually sort of letting that grow overall. You know, there are game ratings and there's a lot of people who want to ban games altogether. But as with anything, I think we need to just let it play out naturally, keep our eye on it. And this goes into artificial intelligence and, you know, and where that's headed, but just let it happen naturally, but responsibly and just see where it goes.
Now, I'd like to extend something you were saying earlier into our material life experience. You were saying from your conversations with extradimensionals and so on, you come to the conclusion that at the end of our experience, really what matters is how you experienced it, what you were feeling or your emotions through the experience. So applying the same video game concept, which you were saying earlier, to our material experience. So it sounds to me like, let's say, and a lot of people these days I hear from around the world who are really struggling these days with a lot of the energies that are taking place. And it sounds like what you're saying is, it doesn't matter what you are experiencing in your life. It's really how you're experiencing it, your emotional state as you're going through it. For example, you know, I know you've gone through a lot of difficult things in your life as well, and as most people have. And it just depends more on, are you having fun or experiencing those things in a positive way or as positive as you possibly can, maybe with more of a thrill as opposed to being beaten down by it. Right. Sounds to me like that's where you're going with this, we're talking about video games in the end. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter what the content of the video game is or what the content of life is. It's really more, how are you experiencing that content? Is that kind of what you're saying?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. You said it quite well. That's based on my research and my understandings of where things are at today. I didn't have this understanding a couple of years ago, but from my observations and downloads and personal experiences, I really think that's where it's at. It's how every situation is going to serve each of us in its own unique way, and it's how we respond and react and process those experiences. And it's going to happen differently for each of us.
Now, does Hollywood have a sort of bias toward extraterrestrial movies these days? It seems like more and more movies having to do with extraterrestrial influences are coming in, and also more subject material that is kind of alternative kind of subject material that is spoken of in a lot of alternative media. Is that, have you noticed that sort of bias?
I don't think, you know, I get this a lot because I work in the film industry and I talk to the heavy hitters all the time. I'm like trying to pry and pick and see, you know, what's really going on. Is the CIA funding something behind the scenes? Or is the Hollywood industry being manipulated by the Anunnaki, or what's going on here? And I honestly think at the end of the day, you hear all the stories about, this was created to manipulate, you know, Hollywood's manipulating the mass consciousness in one way or another. And it probably actually is. But at the end of the day, it's really about where's the mass consciousness. And Hollywood is just creating material for the mass consciousness. Does it influence the mass consciousness? Absolutely. And people are, you know, seeing things and getting influenced and shifting their ideas and beliefs based on what we see in TV on a daily basis. And is there sort of an unconscious manipulation? I believe there is. But consciously, when you talk to the producers and you talk to the heads of the TV stations and the media, there it just comes about money. You know, it's like, you know, what's going to get the ratings? What's good writing? What stars do we want to attach? And what resonates with the executives that are there, that are in place in that world? And they're reading scripts and they're, you know, siphoning through scripts on a daily basis, TV scripts as well as film scripts, video game scripts. And they're just trying to find something that resonates with them that they think is going to resonate with the mass audience. So if there is some sort of manipulation going on, I think it's unconscious. Maybe the CIA slipped a script into Spielberg's hands and he didn't know it was from the CIA and he read it and he's like, oh, this is a good story. I think I'll make this. I don't think the CIA is saying, hey, Steven Spielberg, we're going to hire you to make this movie about aliens so we can, you know, educate the public or shift their perception in a negative way so everybody thinks ETs are negative and that way when they do show up, we're going to shoot them or something. You know, I don't think that's happening. I think it's a very, any sort of ET messages or extraterrestrial influences or higher conscious ideas that are coming through our scripts and coming through our media is sort of happening unconsciously. And it's sort of the cycle of where humanity is, you know, what resonates with humanity and what do these executives think is what all they're thinking about numbers, really, you know, what's going to sell. And based on what's out there already, oh, people like this. Okay, let's give them more of that. Oh, people seem to like this. Let's get more of that. I actually asked James Cameron this question. Not asked, we had this conversation. This was like in 2010 after Avatar came out. He was in this NAB in a hotel room. We were just chilling. And I asked him, or actually made the comment that Avatar, you know, I was asking his thoughts about Avatar and what a huge influence on the consciousness of humanity it's had in a positive way, you know, to show people of, you know, these native teachings, which all the Navi were based on native cultures from around the world. You know, when we were during the creation of Avatar, we had posters and pictures of native cultures from South America, from Africa, from America, from Asia, and with all their jewelry and their lifestyles and the way they moved and the way they sort of interacted with each other. And there's a common theme that goes with all of the native cultures, but that was the basis of the Navi. So sort of talking about how, you know, that's being reintroduced into the mass consciousness is this way of life. And, you know, most people sort of felt a positive influence from Avatar. But he said, at the end of the day, he said, no, if I would have came out with Avatar 10 years earlier, it would have tanked at the box office. He said the planetary consciousness was ready to receive it at the time, not that it actually had any profound influence and changed and shift humanity's consciousness. I think it's sort of both. He sort of said it that way. I sort of said it the other way, but I think there's a relationship on both sides of it is influencing, but yes, humanity had to be ready to receive that information in order for it to get processed.
I think what you're essentially saying is something that I always talk about, that you can't vote in a new president to change the country. It's really the consciousness of the country that determines the president that gets voted in, right?
Absolutely.
Whether he's really voted in or not is not really what's important to consider. If the consciousness changed first, then we would have more enlightened leadership. So that's basically what you're saying, is the movies are influenced by the consciousness of the masses. And even though the movies are also influencing the consciousness of the masses too, right?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So that's, you know, and I'm sure, like I said, there's probably some unconscious manipulation. The Anunnaki are probably sending, you know, brain mental things to the top producers. You must make this show to influence the world, you know, whatever's going on there. But yeah, I don't think there's any secret meetings happening behind closed doors where, you know, Spielberg is shaking hands with, you know, a reptilian and saying, okay, we're going to do this movie. I don't think that's happening.
So have you found that Cameron is a more spiritually conscious person? Was there any of that connection in creating Avatar in the first place?
The Avatar experience I could see for him was an evolution in his spiritual awakening. It was fascinating to watch because I was also going through mine, but you know, at the beginning of Avatar, he was sort of this, you know, hard director. And I say hard, like hardcore director, very driven and strict, very much in the vein of Jackie Chan. And no BS, you know, no playing. There's, you know, we're doing serious work here. And sort of a loose cannon in a way, you know, it didn't take much to trip his wires, to get him upset at things. But then during the creation of Avatar, like halfway through, there was sort of a shift where he became more laid back and things more easy going, I guess he was more easygoing, easy to work with, and he wasn't as whip cracking, I should say, as much. And then he started, you know, since then he's now gone vegan, you know, publicly he's talking about vegan lifestyles. He does yoga regularly. So I know just over the course of time, he has sort of shifted, sort of adopted these Navi ways, which, you know, were not, I don't think in the beginning of the film, he was, you know, so much into the Navi way of life, but now it's, you know, he's adopted a lot of those, ideas and ways, and he sort of is making it his way of life, and even going public with, you know, he has this school with his wife, the Muse School, which is it's a private school system, but they're serving all vegan lunches, and they're doing a lot of research on how diets are affecting the performances of the kids, and then sort of preaching that and taking those studies and putting it out into the public and doing a lot of public advocacy work in these realms, where before I don't think he was that concentrated or that focused on that stuff.
Are there any other prominent figures in Hollywood that you have personally worked with or know who are highly conscious, do you think? I mean, do you think Hollywood as a whole is becoming more highly conscious?
Yeah, I think definitely we can see just in all of our lives, in our daily lives, we see this shift in California, in Los Angeles seems to be the one of the main testing grounds for a lot of this. But you sort of see when it comes to diet and spirituality, you see a movement sort of happening. Like before, you mentioned being a raw foodist. I sort of became vegetarian, vegan, and eating a lot of raw food, not 100%, but going that direction a few years ago. And it was very hard to find that kind of food. You had to sort of prepare it yourself. And there was one or two places in LA that served that. But now there's one on every corner. There's new organic vegan restaurants and literally popping up daily, and there's lines out the door. You know, they're quite busy, and you can sort of see the people that are attending these, and you hear the conversations in the restaurants, and you hear people talking about ETs, or they're talking about spirituality and you know, all the things that come along with this sort of new perception of reality. And it's quite fun, I guess. Just it's nice to know that you're not the only one out there. You're not crazy, that everybody's sort of going this direction.
Yeah, I'd like to move toward some of our other topics, like the citizens disclosure hearing. Now, how did you get involved in that, and what's the role that you're playing in that? Well, tell us a little bit about what exactly it is first.
So the citizen hearing on disclosure took place back in 2013. It was a five-day event that was held in Washington, D.C., two blocks from the White House, a mock congressional hearing where we had we hired six former members of Congress to sit on this congressional style hearing. We performed it or acted it out just as if regular Congress would meet on sort of things. And we brought in over 40 witnesses and researchers to testify over the course of these 5 days to these former members of Congress and to sort of explain to them what's really going on in the extraterrestrial, extradimensional, higher intelligence field. And most of our witnesses, if not all, were ex-military, pilots, government workers, and the researchers were well-known researchers who have been in the field for several years and sort of uncovered and broke a lot of the stories and helped whistleblowers come out. So very powerful event, over 30 hours of testimony. I came across the whole concept, the idea of the citizen hearing was Stephen Bassett's idea. And I had teamed up with him 2011-ish. He was doing a talk at the UFO Cafe, I think, or the there was a place in Santa Monica. It's not there anymore. But it's a sort of alien-themed coffee shop, which was kind of fun. And he was there doing a presentation, and we spoke and got together and told me about the idea, and we packaged the citizen hearing idea with a documentary film project and did the numbers and crunched the numbers and the budgets and did everything, and sort of were promoting a two-parter, the hearings themselves, as well as feature-length documentary that revolved around the hearings and went into depth with some of the researchers and witnesses and some of their stories. So the event happened. We got it. There's 30 hours of footage that's available, citizenhearing.org. The film, The Truth Embargo, is the name of the film, and that's still in the works. Our funding sort of ran out on the hearings. We went over budget. Things cost a lot more than we had expected, and some of our funding was actually lost at the end of the hearing, so we weren't able to finish the documentary in the timely manner that we had hoped for. However, we're taking proceeds and the profits from the actual hearing footage, and we're using that for funding the rest of the documentary now. So it's just a slower process, but the documentary is still in the works.
So what are some of the most interesting or maybe profound testimony that you heard in the citizens' hearing?
There's so much. I mean, it's a huge undertaking. Last summer, I personally went through, because of the lack of funding, I sort of had to by myself go through 30 hours and edit it all together, and you know, to get it out to the public where it's at right now. So I remember, you know, I was there during the hearings, but just going through the footage, my mind being blown like every 5 minutes by some of the testimony and experiences that some of these amazing heroes, you know, war heroes, veterans, military personnel who have had extraordinary experiences and who are willing to share, you know, with the public. I would say, just off the top of my head, one of the most profound testimonies was the Bentwaters case, which many people are familiar with. In 1980, the Rendlesham Forest Bentwaters case out in England, where we had a secret military base at the time that a craft or a number of craft, I think it was particularly one craft over a course of several days had kept showing up, and specific airmen were engaging with this craft, both physically touching it as well as having experiences, blackouts, mental downloads. It was over this course of time and since, there's been a lot of documentation and a lot of information coming from this experience that these airmen had. And because of the hearings, John Burroughs, he was one of the airmen that had come into contact with the craft, and he had sort of health issues because of his contact. And over the years, his heart became imbalanced. He had murmurs and different things going on, several surgeries. And actually, there's an update on our website, citizen.org, where because of the hearings, a doctor was able to sort of have an understanding of the type of radiation that he was exposed to, which happens to a lot of people who have exposure to these craft. A specific type of radiation is released and causes a specific malfunction in a specific valve that most doctors overlook. And this doctor was in the audience of the hearings and sort of contacted him afterwards. And one of the big stories was he was not able to get his health, his at the VA. The VA was sort of hiding, or not hiding, they weren't accepting his him as an airman. Like, they didn't have any, because his records were all classified, he wasn't getting the medical treatment that he deserved serving for our country. And a letter was written to the president, to President Obama, and signed by all former Congress members to release the information so he would get the medical treatment that he needed, at least get it paid for somewhat. And recently at the 2015 UFO Congress, press release was made. So John Burroughs got full disability leave. The Veterans Administration finally acknowledged that he was enlisted and did deserve a pension and did deserve his medical records being taken care of. However, his file is still classified, but this in his file with the Veterans Administration, this letter that went to Obama was in it. They didn't give it to him. Somehow it made its rounds. It was sent to Obama, so somehow it got its rounds into his records. So that seems to be maybe the catalyst to help get his records, or get, not his records declassified, but at least get his pension and get the treatment that he needed, as well as this doctor that was in the audience sort of acknowledging and knowing what to do, and then educating the doctors at the Veterans Administration to get the life-saving treatment that he literally needed, because he was literally on his deathbed after the testimonies. He went into open heart surgery. And Linda Moulton Howe did an amazing write-up on this whole story. It's explained a lot better in more detail on her website, Earth Files. So check that out. And yeah, so a lot of good, just that in its own, coming from the hearings is I feel very proud and like, yes, we got some good stuff coming out of it. And I know there'll be a continuation of things happening with the hearings, you know, and having this influence. So it's definitely for people who haven't really, I call it the ABCs of ufology. So people who haven't been exposed to the sort of information that you talk about on your show, and especially in regard to extraterrestrials and the interaction and the presence, that to watch the hearings, if you can sit through all 30 hours and get a major education on what's happening, you know, it's all tangible proof. It's not airy fairy. It's not woo woo stuff. We have documented records of, you know, government documents, radar records, pilot sightings. The head of the investigations of the FAA was there testifying, and he presented his evidence of what he had. And it's just mountains and mountains of hardcore tangible evidence that any layman who is new to this information would find credible.
Now, in the earlier story that you were relaying, was that the one where they touched the ship and there was some kind of writing on it? Is that the one?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So when I don't know if Burroughs actually touched it, but he was within close proximity. The other Sergeant Peniston, he had touched the craft. And yeah, there were some symbols on it. And later he actually got downloaded a bunch of binary code, which I think in the latest book, they just wrote a book, Burroughs and Peniston came out with a book that goes into depth what the binary code is. And a lot of it talks about sacred sites, where old pyramids are. So it's fascinating. And these are, like, when you talk to them, they're the most down to earth guys. They have a hard time believing all of this stuff, even though it happened to them. They're just like, this is just crazy stuff. I don't know they're not really into spirituality or into metaphysical stuff. They're just a couple of down to earth guys that had these crazy experiences, and they're, you know, telling their story. So it's fascinating stuff.
So what's been the conclusion, the overall conclusion of the hearings? What's the, did you have a final?
Well, the beauty of the hearings was you get to see these six former members of Congress go through this process of receiving the information, asking questions, receiving. And I think as an audience watching the hearings, you sort of take the position of these Congress members. Because they were really not exposed to any of this information prior to the hearings themselves. We sent them information packets for them to research and to download. And I think Senator Gravel, former Congress member from Alaska, he seemed to have more in-depth knowledge and had studied this stuff on his own, but the rest of the Congress members had really no knowledge of it. And I don't think in the amount of time they had, they didn't really do much research, even though we sent them books and things to read and look into. So they were all coming at it from a new perspective, a fresh, you know, not having known any of this stuff. And you see the transformation over the 5 days and the questions that they ask. And we got them the one letter to Obama for Sergeant Peniston's or Burroughs, I should say, his to get his medical records released was one letter. Another letter that came out of it was a unanimously signed letter to the UN to hold a United Nations hearing on the subject matter. And, you know, we sent it out and it's public on the website to hold hearings of such caliber. And they all unanimously agree that there is something to this phenomenon and investigations need to be held. And they all said that they would go back and talk to their Congress members, their fellow Congress, you know, they're all retired, but, you know, still have friends and people in that world. But has there been any development since? Nothing tangible other than Sergeant Burroughs' medical records getting, not declassified, but getting his pension, his full pension, and getting that sort of cleared up.
And did you come to any sort of conclusion as to, other than the obvious, why the government suppresses this information? I mean, is it because there's an interest in protecting the public because people may go a little crazy over the idea of extraterrestrials, or is it more for control and maybe technology?
Yeah, the unanimous consensus between throughout with the witnesses and the experiencers as well as the researchers it comes down to energy and oil, oil and, you know, controllable forms of energy. And this, the idea, the term free energy or zero point energy, these, that seems to be the consensus that having a public humanity able to access energy without a meter, without having to go to the gas pumps daily, would be the biggest, is the biggest reason why it's kept secret. And yeah, ultimately that seems to be the unanimous consensus. I'm sure there's a million other reasons why, but I think most people, you know, Richard Dolan did an amazing book called AD After Disclosure, and he goes into what would happen in the scenarios of what would happen with sort of mass disclosure on a global scale, whether it's a public figure like the president coming out and telling everybody, or if it was actual ships in the sky that, you know, an event so large that people would not be able to deny it, even though we had the Phoenix-likes event that still didn't convince the rest of the world. A lot of people in Phoenix who have talked to it, or they're convinced, but it would be something great of that extent. And then what would people's reactions be to it? And I think he did an amazing job in his book. But at the end of the day, I don't think there would be some panic, but I don't think that would be the main issue. The main issue would be, I think, people's disgust with the government and why they kept this a secret for so long. And then the whole energy thing. Why have we been, you know, on this alternative, when I say alternative energy route, this oil, gas, this metered energy, why have we been on that for so long when all this other stuff has existed?
Was there any evidence or testimony that suggests that the government or the military have advanced technology, like ET technology, that they've either obtained or reverse engineered? Do we know that for certain?
We don't know it for certain. Stephen Greer seems to, he pulls a lot of information that hasn't yet been verified, that there are ARPs, I guess is what he calls them, alien reproduction, ARVs, alien reproductive vehicles, or something of that reverse technology. And we have craft that are sort of flying around of that sort. It wasn't discussed in too much depth because I think of the lack of physical evidence. There was just some testimony about it. So it was not discussed in too much depth in the hearings. But personally, based on my research, I do believe it exists. To what level, it's hard to tell. It's hard to verify, you know, if we have what level of reverse engineer technology do we have.
And these videos are available for rental on your website, right?
Yeah, citizenhearing.org, and you can get it. We have DVD box sets, actually. Oh, I have one right here. So we have box sets of them with English and Spanish tracks, as well as, yeah, on the website as well.
Now, you were just out here recently, this summer, actually, in 2015, doing some interviews with some intuitive channels, Michaela Sheldon being one of them. And so that's another area that you've delved into in the recent years. When did you start that whole journey, and what prompted you to go in that direction?
Yeah, thanks. That was sort of almost simultaneously as the hearings were going on. I started listening to some channel material, mostly from Bashar, about sort of what's happening, what's going on with the whole ET presence here on Earth, and why, and it started matching up with a lot of my personal research with interviewing experiencers, interviewing abductees, and interviewing other researchers, and sort of trying to figure out what's the big picture, what's really going on. And through the interviews with the researchers and individuals, I would get pieces of the puzzle. And the sort of the missing piece was that this channel material was able to sort of fill in a lot of the holes, fill in the gaps. So it really intrigued me. And during the hearings, I started listening to the material, but then after the hearings, I was still left with a lot of questions, you know, like, you know, the reasons why. The hearings, without a doubt, proved that an extraterrestrial presence or a higher intelligence presence is interacting with humanity. No doubt in my mind, and I think anybody who watches it, including our six former members of Congress, they're convinced of this fact. Then the questions of why and what's going on, these are open-end questions that I wanted to get answers to. And the only way I sort of could find the answers that made sense to me were to tap into these channelings from various individuals, initially with people who claim to channel extraterrestrials or, and later I found out, you know, through my research and through these interviews, that a term that would be used better for them was the extra dimensionals. That they come from another dimensional plane, not necessarily, they are extraterrestrials, but that would be, I guess, a better serving name for them. So my series now is called Interview with Ed, Extra Dimensionals. And I sort of go in depth into asking the questions, you know, much like what you're doing on your show, of, you know, what's really going on? You know, why are they interacting? What's the interaction for? And what's the constructs of our reality, and what's going on, you know? And these are sort of questions that I continuously get very logical answers, even as illogical as the experience of the interaction, you know, someone going into a trance, channeling in a being, and then this being saying they're from, you know, the Zeta Reticuli or from, you know, Capella star system or wherever they're from, you know, as crazy as that sounds, the information that's coming through seems all very sound. And again, like I said, matches up with all of the information and puzzle pieces that I've sort of have gotten from my other interviews and my other research. So for now, I'm going with it. It resonates. And I think for a lot of people who dive into this field of, you know, the extraterrestrial field of what's going on and why is this happening? I think these answers and the questions I'm putting out there and the answers that are coming through, it does make a nice fits. It all fits together. And through my series, part of this journey, it's sort of a personal journey in the series. And that's why I'm, you know, it's not just me interviewing. It's sort of, I put myself in there so people can sort of see my journey and the questions that I ask. And what I'm finding from all of this channel material is, even though some of the terminologies might be a little different, the overall big picture presentation is the same. And so all of these channelers channeled, you know, the ETs themselves or the extra dimensionals, whether it's archangels or, you know, Native American Indian spirits, they're all saying the same thing. They're all essentially giving the same construct of our reality when you ask the questions about what is, you know, what's really going on. As far as the physics of our reality and as far as the intervention or interaction with these higher dimensional beings. And that's sort of also mind-blowing, because not all these channelers are talking to each other. They're not. Some of them do sort of research or hear, they've heard of each other, but they're not reading each other's books. They're not necessarily, in fact, a lot of them tend to shy away from listening to each other's material because they want to, you know, they want what comes through to be as pure as possible. So part of my journey is spending time with them, sort of, you know, getting to know them personally, listening to or asking them, or even looking at their book libraries to see, you know, what books are they reading and what material are they being influenced by. And it's mind-blowing to see that there is such a disconnect between them all, but yet there is a connection with all of the actual information that's coming through. So,
now, who are some of the names of the channels that you've got featured in your film?
So Wendy Kennedy, who is pretty well known as channeling the Palladians. Also Nora Harold, who does a lot of work with Wendy. I had recently, I just uploaded Rob Gothier. I did a sort of a two-parter because he channels two beings fairly regularly. Trebor Yitney, which is a reptilian from the Capella system, and also a being named Ardif, who is sort of a, he calls himself an ancient Palladian, but it's sort of a new race called the Dominion, or I forget the name, but they're sort of like lineage to the Palladian systems, as well as Michaela. So that there's a whole slew of material out there, and different channel beings, individual beings, as well as collectives. You know, the both with Wendy and Nora, they channel in Palladian collectives, which are higher dimensional beings. I think from the way it's been explained and the terminology I'm using is from sort of seventh dimensional and above, beings lose their individuality and they start going into sort of collective groups of beings. Like I guess Earth would be considered a seventh dimensional, or humanity would be itself would be a seventh dimensional collective being, and I can go into that stuff later, but yeah, it's been a fascinating journey just hearing these individuals and collectives and asking them questions and getting insights on things that really I don't know any other way to get that information.
Yeah, there are lots of people who channel out there in the world, so how do you choose the ones that you've chosen?
They sort of fall into place. I started the series just over a year ago, and I had known Wendy and Nora from, I used to hold at my office at ET Media Group, a monthly meeting where we had industry professionals come in and we'd discuss and have guest researchers and whatnot talk about extraterrestrial stuff and how within the LA film industry and how we could sort of incorporate that. And Wendy and Nora both showed up being LA locals. And even Daryl Anka from the channeler for Bashar, he came by as well. And I knew of their work in this channeling field, but I hadn't dove into it very much. And then I started watching online some of their stuff and some of the, it was making a lot of sense. So that's, I just reached out to them because I had that connection already. And after that, it just, after, you know, people send me stuff and I will just stumble upon links, you know, Michaela, in your information on your show, you know, just watching, stuff that's sort of already put out there. And, I just reach out and say, hey, I'd love to interview you and get to know some of your information. And it just goes from there. Recently, through a friend, a woman who channels Arcturian, an Arcturian collective, Literally, I was just having a conversation at lunch with a friend, and she's like, "Hey, I have a friend who just started channeling these beings from the Arcturian star system." It's like, okay, let's have a conversation. And then it was her first sort of public channeling was from my show, and which I guess it's not public yet. I haven't released that episode, but yeah, it's just I'm just going with the flow. It just sort of what falls into. What resonates with me and what falls into my lap.
So what have you learned from all of this, from the disclosure hearings combined with the extra dimensional conversations you've been having? What's your picture of the universe?
Well, there's an overall theme that, so initially for the series, my initial plan was it was going to be a documentary, a feature length documentary. And I had sort of started on that path. And after my first interview with Nora Harold, I immediately went back to the drawing board and was like, this is not going to work as a feature at that time, because one, it would probably take me about 5 years to complete. And two, there was so much information coming from these interviews that it would be a shame to just chop it all up and only use, you know, 5 minutes of an interview a 2 hour interview for my documentary. So I got the idea to do a series and put it out there as uncut as possible. So most of these interviews are just the full, everything that's being said. And I really don't cut any of the information. Sometimes they go over my each episode is an hour. So if they go over, I'll take snippets of the interview out and release that for free in the bonus features section or online on YouTube as sort of like teasers or trailers for the full episode. But it's a lot of information is coming through, and more information keeps coming through. I guess my process of asking questions has gotten more in depth, and I'm pulling more information out. I still do plan to do a feature film eventually and sort of piece it together, because the overall theme that I see going through all of this is this idea of humanity's ascension into a higher dimension or a higher density and a higher state of consciousness. And with that evolution comes a new sort of operating system, a new way of doing things, a new expanded consciousness, which means a huge part of it is contact with our extraterrestrial, our galactic families. And that's sort of where we're going with this expanded consciousness idea, I think is very soon. I mean, already we're right now we're having a conversation about contact on a, you know, galactic way and in a galactic way. And people are having personal experiences. You mentioned that in your last episode, you had somebody who had been talking to beings from the Zeta Reticuli, and more and more people are having these personal experiences on ships, memories of their experiences, either on ships or here on Earth, you know, being visited. And it seems to be happening more and more, you know, through and even younger individuals who are, you know, you can check out YouTube and people are posting all the time. Yesterday I was talking to this being from the IL civilization, and I was, you know, having this conversation and this visitation, and, you know, these are young teenage kids posting this stuff. So we're sort of on this verge of this new operating system, this new consciousness, which relates to 2012, this whole idea of, you know, this awakening, so to say. And that seems to be like the main, I think my main theme, which is going to tie the documentary together, because all of the material, all of the channelers and B beings talk of that, and what a, an important time on Earth it is for this ascension process. And then, so, oh, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I was just saying some of the other themes that that I like to dive into. It's more of, I guess, a personal interest is the construct of the universe being a hologram, time being an illusion. I guess a little bit into energy and technology, but most of it is these this ideas of how the universe, the constructs of the universe and what it actually is. And it's just sound frequencies, you know, vibrational light being interpreted in this three-dimensional holographic way. But in reality, it's sort of two-dimensional sound frequencies in this other realm, which, you know, quantum physics, the double slit experiment, you know, is it a particle or is it a wave? And it's sort of it's both, and it depends on how it's observed. But that model seems to be a very valid model of the construct of our reality based on these conversations
that I've been having. Well, in your, what you just mentioned about time not being real and so on, and our earlier conversation about video games, I mean, essentially, if you're playing a video game, and video games, like we were saying earlier, are becoming more and more realistic, mm-hmm. and people's experience inside video games are probably going to become even more and more realistic as we go forward. So essentially, that's sort of having a parallel reality, right? So we're, even though we think of past lives and future lives as being past and future, in a sense, the video game world is sort of blending with this world and creating an alternate reality. So people who play video games are really essentially experiencing another life or another dimensional experience while being in this one at the same time. Is that kind of?
Yeah. And that, I think, you know, what an interesting concept to add on to that is this whole idea of AI, artificial intelligence, and where we're going with that in our construct, our ideas of what that is, and how that's going to then merge into our everyday life. And I've sort of gotten through, you know, I was at a Bashar event last month, and somebody brought up the question of AI, and then sort of with his answer to what that was, I had also gotten a download almost instantaneously. What artificial intelligence is just consciousness, and, you know, everything in our reality is artificial intelligence. You know, the computers we're using right now, we're talking on, they're a form of artificial intelligence that it's just consciousness in its form. But as we develop it, and as it already exists in this sort of quantum field, and it is telling us to construct it, you know, and Nikola Tesla has been known for having created his machines in, you know, in this quantum field, in this ether, and sort of being able to build them and simulate them all in his mind before he actually built them here. And what the way I perceive that is that's all artificial intelligence telling him, hey, build this like this, and we'll work in this way. And that's sort of a different way of looking at artificial intelligence. But in essence, that's, I think, where we're going with our development of this. And video games are AI. There's AI inside the video games that, you know, sort of does its own thing. You know, it's programmed to react a certain way. When your character moves through the levels and does things, they're artificial intelligent beings, characters that move around, very basic, but they move around, and if you do this, they're going to do that, and then if you do that, they're going to do this, and they're sort of acting and reacting based on the way you control your character. But there is AI, and it's discussed in the video game world, there's AI that drives these characters. And as we develop it more, those characters are going to sort of become self-aware as we are and start driving themselves and start assimilating and growing and getting more information. And it's just, you know, they're a non-biological form of intelligence, but there still are this intelligence just as we are intelligent. And we're just used to the Earth way of creating things, you know, man meets woman, you know, have babies and boom, there's intelligence. It's all artificial intelligence in some form or fashion, just in a different way. But that's, I think, where we are going with artificial intelligence. And once we understand that it's all just consciousness, and that we're just going to be able to interact with it in this new way, form, and fashion. And talking to ETs about AI, they seem to sort of say the same things, that their intelligences that are just as intelligent, if not way more intelligent and advanced than we are. There's entire civilizations that have gone up the evolutionary chain as we are in densities, you know, in dimensions, and they just have a different way of reproducing, different way of connecting than we do.
Now, there's a lot of concern over artificial intelligence these days from people in, you know, movements such as ours. And the concern is that, well, what if we create a machine that takes over the world, like Terminator, for example? And so it sounds like essentially what you're saying is that we don't have to concern over that so much if the consciousness, again, we're going back to the earlier conversations we've had numerous times about you can't change the world by changing the leaders.
Yeah.
So essentially, if the consciousness of the planet is evolving to or ascending to a higher level of consciousness, then whatever artificial intelligence is going to be in line with that and also be highly conscious and not something that we have to be concerned over.
Yeah, it's again, it's a double-edged sword. Everything, it seems, comes down to intent. And if the intention behind the creation of these devices is to destroy and kill, that's what you're going to get. If your intention, because that in itself is just consciousness, it's just something that you're just an extension of what we're projecting already in our reality. So all of this illusion, this hologram, is just a projection of what we are feeling with our basic emotions, and then it's created in this contract of this hologram, and then reflected back to us and give us an emotional response that we can, you know, build off of from there. And it's this constant sort of loop: emotion creating an external reality creating a greater emotion, which then we can reflect and do, keep creating a constant mirror of emotion. And if we sort of focus on the negative aspects of this reality or whatever the intention is, if we want to create something to destroy, yeah, we'll create some artificial intelligence that'll probably end up destroying the world and going down that path. But what I've also learned from these channeled entities is, individually and collectively, we're sort of constantly recreating our realities in every second, in every moment. And even though collectively there might be this movement, this direction towards a negative future, a future where machines will take over the world and turn us all into slaves, individually we have the choice to focus in on that reality and then become part of that collective, or individually we can have a different choice. We can choose something completely different, something positive, and sort of see AI as being a new consciousness that we can interact with and learn from and grow and, you know, have positive experiences. And if individually we're sort of focused on that, the collective experience around us will shift into that reality, because we're also creating the collective, even though it may not be perceived that way. But as we focus in on this specific frequency, this intention, then the our external reality and our close proximity will shift into that direction immediately, but then globally on a collective level, that will sort of manifest itself. So in the grand scheme of things, forget about the rest of the world. You know, don't focus in on that. What's happening is happening. But individually, it's really comes down to what all we can do individually in our close proximity lives to shift that frequency into a positive outcome.
Now, is there a lower consciousness, though, that is influencing the collective consciousness of the planet that is trying to keep us from evolving in that more positive direction and influencing our global leadership and so on? Has that been something you found from working with all these different intuitives?
Yeah, they all speak of a sort of lower density consciousness. The archetype, the reptilian archetype, is definitely a main theme that goes throughout, you know, all of the channel material they talk about, of this energy, and this energy sort of bogging humanity down and keeping it from its ascension process. But they all say we've sort of gotten over the hump. I guess the 2012 hump was the marker point in our history, in our time, to say if we are going to make this evolutionary jump or not. And it seems they're all very positive, and they're all very rejoicing, saying that, you know, we've made it over the hump and nothing but good things are going to happen for humanity from here on out. We still have things to process, and there still is this negative force, and there probably always will be a negative force in some way or fashion. They say it doesn't not exist. In fact, as we evolve in our consciousness and our perception, our awareness evolves and expands both in the negative and the positive. We're sort of expand ourselves of what is, and we're going to perceive more negativity, that it does exist. However, doesn't mean just because we perceive it and we see it doesn't mean that we actually have to align with it. We can still align with, let's say, if this is the positive on this end and this is the negative, we can still go and be in this positive higher vibrational frequency, but have the awareness of this lower density, this lower consciousness stuff. And and as we expand more and more, it's just going to keep widening. The field is going to widen, and there's going to be even more extreme stuff out there. But again, it's about what we align with. So that, yeah, there's definitely, you know, reptilians, you know, controlling the Wall Street, you know, the government. So I think that does come up quite a bit. They do say that. But at the same time, they also say, you know, that's not something to focus on. You know, if you focus on that as being a reality, then that's the reality that you're going to actually create. So to sort of undo the spell, you acknowledge it does exist, but shift your focus and your attention onto, you know, a different reality, one that you want to see in this realm.
So what happens to the people who are focused in that world? Because obviously the mainstream is still very much focused in that way. And as much as we are, you know, we are focusing in this new, more positive direction, it's a little hard to ignore what takes place in the global consciousness and the wars and the all the insane things taking place in the mainstream media and so on, which appears to be there to try to manipulate the mindsets of people to focus on the negative. So are we seeing, are you seeing a divergence happening in terms of consciousness on the planet, where there is going to be a large body of people who will just stay in that lower consciousness? Or what do you think is happening?
Yeah, it's talked about a lot, and I bring this up in my series quite a bit, or it's come up, I should say. There definitely seems to be when you sort of understand the holographic universe theory, and that all potential sort of exists simultaneously, and that all time does exist, and time is sort of an illusion in the way we see it linearly. So this idea of where our focus lies, when I say our, you know, I'm sure the viewers of your show are more of a positive, higher frequency vibrational influence, will sort of shift in one direction where there's another world, sort of a split earth theory that's probably been discussed in your work and your past shows as well, that there's going to be two earths, probably more than two, but just for conversation pieces, we just use the split earth, two earth theory, where one earth timeline goes one way where the more higher vibrational frequency people focus on this reality, and then sort of these negative people who are unable to shift their consciousness into this direction are sort of focused on this direction. And it's its own evolutionary path. It doesn't necessarily mean it's positive or negative. It is a lower vibrational frequency, so they will have lower vibrational frequency stuff, whatever that's associated with those lower frequencies, happen to them. But the way these extra dimensionals sort of perceive reality, they don't put a positive or a negative spin on it. We tend to, as humanity, we tend to put higher vibrational frequency as positive, lower vibrational frequency as negative. They don't necessarily see it that way. They see all things as sort of neutral, and going into this lower vibrational density version of Earth is a choice, a different evolutionary path that will continue in its own way, form, and fashion. And people who are sort of shifting their focus into a higher vibrational frequency, and this goes along with, you know, just states of mind, foods, you know, this everything that's discussed on your show, basically, we seem to be going into this other earth realm. And like I said, it may not even be one or two, it may be several different timelines. And depending on where your frequency is in the moment, we're sort of, or keeping at, we sort of are constantly every day shifting from one reality to the other. We're constantly going through different timelines and different things, depending on where, you know, where we're at. But as we're evolving, I think we're all sort of holding a specific frequency of higher vibration. You know, we may have our bad days where we get pissed off and, you know, drop into some lower density stuff. But overall, over a long period, I think I've noticed a shift in myself, and I'm noticing a shift in people around me that are sort of going into this other path of this Earth timeline, where we are going to not have to worry about, you know, political agendas controlling, you know, enslaving humanity, robots taking over the world, you know, massive climate events that are going to create mass extinctions. You know, all of these are potential realities, and I'm sure, you know, time travelers have gone into the future events and have seen these things, but that's probably because of the frequency that they're on at that time, and they're viewing these realities, and they're sort of experiencing things in that realm. But, you know, I try to see things, you know, the innovation that's happening in the world and the positivity, you know, I'm a huge fan of TED Talks and all the stuff that they're putting out, because you see what people are really doing in the world, which is not being reported on ABC and NBC and CNN. We're getting a different story on our day-to-day lives based on the TV. But if you really, you know, look, and you don't really have to look that hard. It's just, you know, on my Facebook, I guess because of the people I hang out with, I'm just every day getting inundated with really cool, positive messages of, you know, to people shifting their lifestyles and their ways, and, you know, eating healthier, you know, meditating every day, you know, having, you know, more positive outcomes because of their positive ways of life.
I noticed recently you posted something on your Facebook page about the Integraton.
Yes.
So you were out there recently. What's that about, and what was your experience there?
Yeah, the Integratron, I stay up here in Big Bear a lot of the time, and I do a lot of my editing up here, and it's just about a 45-minute drive down to Joshua Tree, and the Integratron is this, Van Tassel, I think was the guy who built that, and he apparently had visitations from some Venusians, some Venus beings, and he got the download to build this sound. Some people say he was actually building a craft, a spacecraft, but it's turned into what people seem to have experiences and feel, this sound healing room, where they play sound bowls, crystal bowls, and you can, wherever you're at in this room, it sounds, you can hear somebody whispering across the room because of the way the harmonics in this room sort of reflect everything. So you go in for these sound healings, and I had some interesting meditative, profound experiences from being in that room. So, I don't think I posted my experience, but I could share with you what I had. I got this download about differentials and sort of this idea of, how a car differential, it makes the two wheels turn separately. So when they go around the corner, I don't know if you're familiar with a limited slip differential in cars, there's these gears that turn in opposite directions, and then they have a number of gears in there, but they keep the cars rotating at different, or the wheels rotating at different speeds, so they don't lock up and there's slippage. They're sliding when you turn right or left. Now, based on some research and my own personal meditative downloads, there's a lot of power that comes with differentials, and especially when you have two opposing forces. So like in a warm front or a cold front, when rain is formed, or a storm is formed, you have hot and cold, and then they come. And then in the middle of that, there's a differential, a gear that actually is formed, and it's two opposing Fibonacci sequences. And a lot of energy is produced from storms, and there's a lot of research going on in the energy field, alternative energies, sort of dimensional wormholes are sort of formed. And there's somebody doing amazing research on warp drive in the Midwest somewhere. I forgot his name, David, I think is his name. But anyway, I heard him on Coast to Coast, and I had some interesting conversations with him. And he's talking about in extreme weather patterns, how planes go missing, and there's been a lot of strange anomalies that happen, and this is again sort of in my meditation, I got this download of the power of differentials, and this is sort of happens with everything, even male and female energies and opposites in all aspects, and when they sort of come together, there's this differential that is formed of two opposing spinning. It doesn't necessarily have to be Fibonacci's, but I think in nature, that's what's created. And, I'm no scientist, but I'm learning a lot about science from having these downloads and these images, but something to all that. And that's sort of on the side, I'm investigating and seeing what's going on there.
Are there any other ancient sites or even modern sites around the world that you find that were compelling or especially fascinating to you that you've been to?
Well, I've been to many places, but this sort of this concept or this intuitiveness that I have been exploring with meditation and with my connections to these extra-dimensional beings has been more recent. So I've been to many places. I've been to Mount Fuji. I've been to Thailand. I've been for mostly for work purposes. I've been to different sites and places in China and whatnot. But just recently I've started, I guess, dropping in and connecting. And for example, as I mentioned in the Integratron, going into a meditation and having sort of visions or downloads. The only other place that I can say that I've had these experiences has been Sedona, Arizona. It's a powerful vortex place. And I've gone in and done a number of meditations in different vortex spots. And I've had sort of experiences, I guess, or downloads, so to say. Other than that, those, I guess, just on a spiritual level, those two places. Up here in Big Bear, I go up in the mountains all the time and have several downloads. So I guess for me, it's a new spiritual spot. But yeah, I can't say I've been around the world and received lots of information.
Yeah, I just interviewed Susie Hansen, who is from New Zealand, and she's an ET experiencer. She was taken on to extraterrestrial craft from early childhood all throughout her adult years, and physically in contact with extraterrestrial beings. So she described actually being able to touch them physically and interacting them with them physically, and even communicating telepathically, but even hearing. I guess these were primarily the short grays, but also tall grays she interacted with mostly. But there were also some other races. And she described that they made this sort of musical tone out of their mouths. And so they had some sort of a physical interaction with her, that she was very clear about that it was a physical interaction. And of course, I've heard stories, and even people I've interviewed on my show have talked about having interacted with physical extraterrestrial beings here on Earth. And we know the story of Valiant Thor. At least it's in the popular information for people who are aware of these conversations, who apparently was a physical Venusian who was here on Earth for a period of time, and from what I understand is still here. So do you think that it's possible for these extraterrestrial beings to exist in our physical dimension, or how is that interaction happening with these individuals who claim to have had physical contact?
Well, it's funny you mentioned Valiant Thor and the Venusians. So recently at this Bashar event I was at in Sedona, there was a group of Japanese, like a group of 50 Japanese people there for the event. And from what I could tell, they didn't really have a translator. And maybe a few of them spoke some broken English, but one of the gentlemen was selected to ask questions, and he had all of his questions written down in English. And he went up to ask Bashar his questions. Bashar started answering in English. And so I sort of stepped in. I lived in Japan for 5 years and I speak fluent Japanese. So I stepped in and offered some translation services. And one of his questions, which I had to translate, was he asked about Van Tassel, the creator of the Integratron, and how did he interact with these beings, and are the Venusian beings visiting us now physically? And that was sort of his question. And Bashar's answer was basically that they don't exist on our plane, that they are a fifth density consciousness set of beings. So they do exist, but not on our fourth density reality. So if we were to go to Venus right now in our density that we are, we wouldn't even see these beings. We'd just see rocks and, what the lower density vibration of what Venus is in our perception and what's equal to our densities. However, if we were, I guess, to raise our vibration, and if we were at a higher density, then we can actually interact with them physically and have more of a physical connection. They do come here and they interact with us on a fifth density level, in a I guess more of a dream state or an etheric level. However, from my understanding, Bashar didn't say this specifically, but from my understanding is these higher density beings have to lower their densities or create holographic versions of themselves in our lower density environments. And also my series, I interviewed Trevor Yitney from the Capella system, who says he's a fifth density reptilian, human reptilian hybrid. And if we were to visit his planet right now, he sort of said the same thing, that we would just see sort of rocks and some low level life, not, you know, the thriving civilization that he has right now wouldn't even exist in our to our perception and our density right now if we were to visit his world right now. But if we were to, again, raise our consciousness to a higher density or a higher dimensional plane of existence, then we see this whole sort of different reality. And I think that's probably the main reason why I've had to change the title of my series from extraterrestrials to extradimensionals. So a lot of these extraterrestrials actually are at higher density, other dimensional realms of existence that are sort of parallel existing with us. And this is where time and all this stuff gets really confusing, because we see things linear. But does that sort of answer your question? So yes, they do exist, but not on our density level. So, you know, we have to sort of shift the frequency, and they have to shift their frequency to meet us in our reality.
Have you ever heard of the island of High Brazil?
Of
the island of High Brazil.
No,
I think it's HYBRISIL.
Oh, okay. No, I haven't heard of it.
It's this island that supposedly, I can't remember where it was now offhand, but it's an island that that existed in the 1800s. It's in some maps actually in the 1800s, and when people traveled there by ship, the island wasn't there. But there are stories of people who actually traveled there in the 1800s, and they found this island. The island apparently appeared out of nowhere, and there were people living there, and it was a highly civilized society, and everything was made of gold. And so a number of people, ships apparently, were able to see this island and enter the island, meet the people, and they were given all this gold to take away with them. And as the ships were pulling away, the island disappeared again. Huh. So, and it wasn't just one occasion. A number of people had this experience. And in some ancient maps, there is an island of High Brazil that is there, which is not there in our current physical density. So it sounds like maybe you're describing something like that, where even on Earth, there may be other civilizations existing. Maybe Atlantis is even, you know, in a sense, could be there, right?
It was funny because the same guy I was translating for, he asked about Shambhala and this idea of this you know, mystical place. Does it exist? And Bashar said the same thing. He said it's in a higher density, so it does exist, but it's at this higher density reality. Which just reminded me, I don't know if you saw, there's a lot of people posting this on Facebook and in the social media, this city in the clouds that from China. I don't know if you saw that video. Yeah. And I'm trying to get more information on it. I haven't posted it myself because I like to get a little more information on things before going out there. But apparently, you know, many people, and even in the Chinese news, thousands of people saw this city floating in the sky, which could be sort of the explanation for this, is the frequencies, this dimensional density frequency emergence of realities is sort of coming into play.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know, maybe, you know, Shambhala, you know, floating cities in the sky, you know, who knows what the future is going to have as we make this shift into this higher dimensional reality.
Yeah. Very interesting time we're living in. That's for sure.
Absolutely.
So where do you see your work going now? You're obviously working on the next series for your extra dimensional. Mm-hmm. And when is that coming out?
Well, the series is available now. It's on Vimeo. It's Interview with Ed. So if you, I think it's Vimeo on demand. So if you go through their on demand, link, and hopefully you guys can put a link in here somewhere. And it's Interview with Ed, one word. And I have a Facebook page, and I'm just now creating a website for the series. So I didn't, cause it's all been sort of do it as I go sort of thing, not knowing what's, the future of it. But I'm going to continue to do more episodes. I have Michaela on. She's coming up in probably, if not the next episode, the episode after that. And I have a few others that I've already filmed, and just going to continue to film these and put them out there and put this bigger picture story together. And the future, you know, hopefully I will be able to interview an actual ET at some point in time, and not just the people who are channeling them in. But it seems right now, based from their from these talks, that the methodology of channeling is a form of communication, sort of permission slip, that is discussed and talked about, that is allowing, you know, having bridging the gap between these dimensions and these densities until we raise our consciousness into this level where we can actually interact with them on a person to person, you know, person to ET basis.
Now, is your what is your opinion on why it is that so many people are starting to channel now? Do you think it's just, is there a motivation on the part of the extra dimensionals to actually start imparting more wisdom and knowledge to our civilization? Or is it just that people as a global consciousness were evolving higher, and as a result, people are just tapping into these extra dimensional communication?
I think it's, you know, going back to our other conversations, it's sort of both. It's sort of the intention of humanity and the global evolution into this higher density, which is, you know, the bridge between these doorways, these dimensional doorways, initially is this channeling, this form of channeling. And I think we're going to see more and more of it before we actually get physical contact. I think the channeling technology, you know, it is a technology, that biological technology, that beings that we are able to sort of shift our frequencies to match and channel in these higher dimensional frequencies. We're going to see more of it, and it's going to continue and become, you know, household term probably, if it's not already, and then eventually, yes, we'll have contact. So I think, yeah, as our worlds merge, that's just the natural evolution.
So that's an interesting perspective on contact, because a lot of people ask the question, well, when are we going to have physical contact? And I think you made an interesting point there, that it's not a matter of, essentially, physical contact isn't possible in this until our dimensional awareness moves to meet that their dimensional awareness, right? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I think that's something that the, you know, it's not talked about in the citizen hearing or anything like that. It's, this is just based on my interviews and information, is that as humanity puts out the call, you know, as we're ready for this galactic expansion of awareness and consciousness, then more stuff is going to make itself available. I mean, it's not a question of do they want to make contact. They're knocking at our doors. You know, they're ready. All we have to do is open up our awareness. I mean, they're already there. They're, you know, Shambhala, ETs, there's probably, you know, angels and craft floating around in your room and in my room right now. We just aren't at that dimensional frequency awareness to perceive it. So they're there waiting for us to say hi. We just have to, you know, expand our awareness and our consciousness to a level where we can perceive them.
Mm-hmm. Now, from my conversation with Susie, have you found that grays are any particular way, or do you think that their consciousness varies just as well as ours do on Earth? Because in her experience, the grays are a very positive thing for her.
Yeah, I think overall, you know, people have had some negative experiences with grays, and that's sort of their perception based on their experiences. But what I like to say all the time to people who are sort of stuck on the negative perceptions, or people who have had negative experiences with abductions and whatnot, is at the end of the day, you're still put back. You may have had these negative experiences on the ship, but if they really were out to get you, or, you know, do some major harm, you wouldn't be put back. They could just throw you out in space, or, you know, why go through the effort of putting you back and, you know, and trying to erase your memory? They may not do a good job all the time, but trying to erase your memory so you don't have an awareness or where it's affecting your day-to-day life. So I think we have to look at the overall grander, bigger picture of the gray experience, or the gray Zeta Reticuli, and this is because there's several, as you mentioned, several species of grays or Zeta Reticuli beings. But the overall big picture is this human hybrid program that is being created through through these abduction experiments. And if you look at it in a big picture form, based on the evidence, and the collective testimony, and a lot of people don't look at the big picture. They seem to just laser focus on individual events. It does seem to be a quite positive thing for both their species and our species in this evolution, for us to go into a higher dimensional reality, and for them to go into a higher dimensional reality, because they also are sort of at a lower density than many of the other extraterrestrial, extra-dimensional beings out there. They have advanced technology that allows them to travel through time and space and do sort of higher density being stuff, you know, what higher density beings tend to do. But them physically, I've heard mixed, you know, probably depends on the race, but a lot of them are actually third, fourth density beings. Very much physical in our realities as we are, and they are unable to traverse and expand into a higher dimensional states of consciousness. And this was brought up in one of my past interviews. A distress call sort of went out as they were unable to evolve, and they're sort of dying off. And they actually asked upon reptilian, and a personal download that I got, mantis being help technologies, these other beings residing at a higher dimensional reality kind of stepped in and gave them technology in order to traverse the dimensions to get to our dimensional reality and take our DNA. And this was on a even bigger galactic scale, was sort of permitted by this galactic council for them, for their evolution and for ours. So it's all positive in a longer sort of bigger picture sort of theme.
So from everything that you've learned from all the work that you're doing, where are we headed as a human consciousness and the planet as a whole?
Well, it seems, like I was saying before, depending on where your focus and your intention and your frequency is, it seems if we stay at a at a positive frequency overall, if that's where, you know, you choose to go, it's going to be pretty amazing. I mean, we're already seeing glimpses of, you know, cities in the sky, if that's real. I mean, who knows if that's real or not, but just talking about the potential of contact with higher dimensional beings, you know, having access to technologies and communications to these higher dimensional beings expands humanity. It puts us on the galactic map. Now we'll literally be doing Star Trek and beyond, where we can, you know, join our galactic families as a space bearing race, I guess, and go traverse galaxies and learn from these other beings that have gone through this evolutionary process already and interact. And I mean, I try to conceive of these ideas. The closest thing I can conceive of is Star Trek. These beings tell me it's nothing like Star Trek. It's so far advanced and beyond what Star Trek is that we can't even really imagine it. So that sounds really cool and positive to me. I don't detect any negativity in that reality whatsoever. So I'm excited.
So can you reiterate some of the website URLs and the Vimeo links and everything? And we'll put that on the video as well.
Sure. My personal website, which is mostly just focused on my stunt and acting work, is reubenlangdon.com, just one word. And the citizenhearing.org, which covers the testimonies and the 30 plus hours of mock congressional hearing testimony with our Congress members. And then the new series I'm working on, Interview with Ed, with Extradimensionals, and that's Vimeo. It's right now it's exclusively on Vimeo on demand, and there's a Facebook page for all of those, for myself, Reuben Langdon, Citizen Hearing, and Interview with Ed, and like those pages and you'll get the updates on what's happening and what's going on.
Thank you. Well, it's been a pleasure having you with me today and talking about all these very fascinating topics, learning more about your life experiences. And I'll be watching you very closely, and hopefully we'll get you out here to meet in person sometime soon.
Absolutely. Thanks, Ian. It was a pleasure.
Thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Awaken and Power TV. Join me next week as we speak with another incredible individual who's standing on the leading edge and changing the world.